Hachette Audio presents Shield Maiden. Written by Sharon Emmerichs. Read by Victoria Fox.
For every girl and woman who wants to be a shield maiden. Précis. The old English poem Beowulf, produced somewhere between 975 and 1015 CE, recounts the tale of the superhuman hero-turned-king, Beowulf, who fights and kills three monsters. Grendel, who kept eating people in Denmark, Grendel's mother, who wanted revenge for her son's death, and a dragon who destroyed Beowulf's village in the 50th year of his reign in Geatland. Beowulf demonstrates superpowers during his battles, feats of great strength, and the ability to hold his breath underwater for hours, for example. This novel concerns the last battle, with the dragon. The original poem tells us that an unnamed slave, who had been exiled from his master's house, found a secret way into a dragon's lair filled with treasure. He steals a goblet, which wakes the dragon, who rains havoc and fire down upon the land. This is the story of that slave, and the woman who loved, inspired, and believed in him. Part 1. Prologue. Geatland, in the year 987 CE. On the morning of her 13th birthday, Fryda of clan Wegmunding, daughter of Weirsdan, and jewel of King Beowulf's eye, wanted only one good kill. She wished for a sturdy arrow shot straight and true, the rending of flesh under her knife, and the tang of hot blood sending curls of steam into the chill air. In the pre-dawn darkness, she wriggled her way into trousers pilfered from the laundry the day before. The icy glimmer of stars peeped through the smoke hole cut into the roof as she pulled on a rough-spun tunic and fastened a leather belt around her childishly slim waist. Good, she thought. No one in the household would stir for another hour at least. She gathered her wild, butter-coloured curls into thick braids and wound them around her head, hoping the pins would hold, and slid a short seax, a sharp, tapered hunting dagger, under her belt. For a moment, she considered fetching Theo from his pallet in the kitchens and asking if he wanted to come with her. As Theo's name hovered in her mind, she felt a small frisson shimmer up her spine. Her breath quickened, the hairs on her arms stood up, and her young body woke in ways she did not entirely understand. She nearly surrendered to the rush of temptation that tugged her towards the kitchens, but did not want to risk Theo receiving credit for her hunt. A warrior gets credit for his kills. Her kills, she thought, or at least, one kill to prove her prowess at the hunt. One wolf pelt to hang in the mead hall and call her own. She grabbed her bow and a quiver of arrows from her wooden chest and crept from the building, trying to be as silent as possible. In the early morning hush, every step, every breath sounded unnaturally loud, and she startled at each rustle and distant bird call. Her breath misted in the late autumn air, but the nights were not yet cold enough to freeze the dew that pearled on the grass, making everything smell fresh and green. Fryda made her way towards the western wall, stealing through the burr as quietly as she could. In the hovering darkness of the far northern autumn, the structures resembled a sprawling village rather than a walled estate. Warm, reddish earthen walls rose in square and rectangular blocks, adorned by thatched timbered roofs and arched windows set with real glass, sparkling like gemstones. Wooden structures hunkered in rows around an ancient standing stone. The air smelled like salt and brine, and she could hear the distant thunder of waves crashing against the rocky shore. She nodded to the guards stationed at the gate, and they let her pass without question. She had no doubt they would report her early morning exit from the burr to her father. But by that time, she hoped, she would have a fine wolf pelt to placate him. Fryda padded through a wooded grove outside the stronghold wall, avoiding rustling leaves and noisy twigs. Soon her boots were soaked through, and a chill pebbled her skin, but she did not think about turning back. Shield maidens did not stop fighting because of damp feet. She scanned the ground as she moved, alert for any sign of the beast that had plagued the Burr's hunters since summer's end. After several cold, breathless moments, she spotted the paw prints of an enormous wolf in some soft mud and steadily tracked them westward. They led her out of the woods to the bare, wind-ravaged meadows along the edge of the cliff. Elation filled her, making her feel as if she floated above the ground. She was going to find the wolf. She would find it and kill it, and her father would finally see her as a worthy shield maiden. He would finally let her. Her thoughts rattled out of her head as the earth beneath her shuddered and jerked. Fryda gasped as she staggered, trying to keep her feet. A terrifying roar filled her ears, a sound so monumental she thought Woden himself must have made it. Certainly no wolf could produce such a clamour. The ground shifted sideways and violently flung her into the grass. A sharp report echoed across the sky, as if the very fabric of the air cracked and tore. The meadow undulated beneath her as though suddenly turned to water, and Fryda clutched the long grass in her fists. The coarse blades tore in her grip as the earth tried to shake her off like a flea in a dog's fur. The great cracks and rumblings became deafening, and Fryda sobbed in terror. The ground lurched and then disappeared. For one breath, she lay on solid, if tumultuous, ground, and the next she plummeted downwards. A scream tore from her throat, and she clawed with frantic hands for anything to break her fall. Something grabbed her by the wrist, and for one breathless moment, she thought Woden had indeed stretched out a hand to save her. But when a lightning bolt of pain shot from her hand down to her shoulder, Fryda understood why the clan revered the All-Father as the god of madness as well as death. She screamed again, as her hand became fire and flames licked through her arm, her shoulder, and into her chest. She blinked against the sparks dancing across her vision and wondered if disobedience to her father had truly brought about the end of the world. The violence of the earthquake had hollowed out a deep, deep chasm in the earth, and she'd managed to jam her hand into a narrow crack in the wall. Fryda stared at the shards of white bone jutting from her ruined skin, the wells of shocking red blood running down her arm. It dripped from her fingers onto her neck, her face, into her clothing, and fear rushed to fill the spaces of her body left empty by leaking blood and protruding bone. She clutched the wall with her good hand while her feet scrabbled against the rock, trying to find purchase. But every movement caused great flowers of pain to bloom in her hand and chest, and she realized the fall had separated the bones of her arm completely from her shoulder. Time began acting strangely. She had no idea how long she hung there, drowning in agony and hoping she would soon die. Eventually, the darkness of night crept into her bones. Her throat burned with thirst and screams. Her eyes grew dim. Her body shook with cold and weakness. Her arm and shoulder had gone numb hours before, but her hand seethed with pain from the bones piercing her skin and from the rock that kept her trapped like a rabbit in a snare. She screamed again, her voice feeble and wounded, and heard an answering music rise from the bottom of the chasm, a tinkling like bells or chimes. It wasn't real, of course. She knew that now. Once night had claimed the land, she had fallen into a kind of delirium wherein she heard and saw things from the wrong side of reality. Strange phantasms from her life that could not possibly exist in this place, and time hovered around her, like the scent of Hild's delicious mushroom soup, or the tang of the ground ghouls the hunters used for tanning skins. Perhaps the visions, the scents, the music were heralds of her death. If so, she welcomed them. The torment from her trapped hand writhed through her body like a living thing. The hours since the earthquake had not acted as a balm for her pain. She thought, as she had 1,000 times since she fell, about the hunting knife tucked in her belt. She whimpered. Her hand, with all its torn flesh and broken bones, had swollen so rapidly she could not budge it from its rocky prison. But she could wrap her belt around her arm, tighten it. Take the knife and... A gust of wind from the sea snaked through the chasm and buffeted her against the cliff wall. Fryda screamed in earnest as her broken wrist twisted and the bones ground together. She fumbled for the seeks at her waist, but her fingers faltered as the darkness closed in on her, and she gratefully succumbed to her fate. Awareness. Deep in her cave, buried under a massive pile of treasure, Fyrdraka, fire dragon, shifts. She feels the touch of gold and silver slide against her scales. For a moment, she almost wakes. But something catches her and drags her back down into nightmare, like a drowning victim caught in an intractable undertow. Not a nameless something, an ancient curse. Fyrdraka struggles against the dark magic that binds her, and the earth trembles at her strength and power. The gold and treasure are her prison as well as her savior. She reaches out, longing again to be free, to stretch her wings and fly. From her nightmares, she lashes out at the barrier keeping her from the winds and clouds, and the ground shakes again. A sound like a thunderclap reverberates through the cave, and this time the land cracks, fractures into long, deep fissures of jagged rock and stone. The earth barrier between her precious gold and the sky breaks, splits, and for the first time in centuries, the sun reaches.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.